So my name is Loïc Denuzière, and I'm here with my colleagues from IntelliFactory, and I'm going to be talking here about WebSharper, and more specifically WebSharper UI Next. So who are we? So IntelliFactory. So we are a Hungarian company created in 2004. Yes, F-Sharp existed in 2004, as incredible as it may be. And so we're best known for being creators of WebSharper, the web ecosystem that I'm going to talk about, and the CloudSharper online development / application environment. And we also do a lot of consulting on F-Sharp web applications mainly, and we provide some training on F-Sharp and on WebSharper. So let's talk about creating web applications. So how are they generally structured? So the way it generally goes is that, as we were talking about just before, we have the server side on one hand, which has all the database aspects, which has the model layer on top of that, which has the static views. What I call the static views is all the HTML that is served as is. It may be generated, but what is generated on the server side. Ajax endpoints, if there are calls from the client for dynamic behavior, and dispatching requests to serve either static views or Ajax endpoints. And then in the client side, in a completely different language and a completely different everything, you have dynamic views potentially, that some views are generated in JavaScript. You have dynamic behaviors, animations, data verifications, things like that, and calls to the Ajax endpoints. So if you have so typically an application is going to be a lot of different bits of functionality, and each of these bits of functionality is going to be split between these two parts, and this means that there's a mismatch between the way you think about your application. There's this functionality and that functionality, and the way it actually ends up being implemented. So the purpose of WebSharper is to reduce or even remove this mismatch. So instead of having server-side code on one hand, client-side code on one hand, we have compilation from F-sharp to JavaScript, which allows us to have the client-side code written together with the server-side code, and therefore you can structure your application in the same way as you conceptualize it. So you have your, on the server you have your model aspects, the database, the model layer, things like that. You have the, what some people would call the controller, which will dispatch the requests and things like that. And you can have everything that is view related together in a piece of code. Everything that is view related for a given functionality is going to be a code unit, and another functionality is going to be another code unit. So when you're working on the view for this piece of functionality, you don't need to switch between I'm doing some server-side bit, I'm doing some client-side bit, and these are completely different. You can have everything done together. So for example, let's say we want to write a small blog application that's readable.
Yeah, probably not. Is it easy to switch the background color?
Well, I think it's good enough.
It's good enough. So here's the server request dispatch part
the way you would write it with WebSharper. So you define a type, a union, an F-sharp union type that represents all the HTTP endpoints that are reachable from your application, and each of those is a case in your union. So here we have, this is an application with a little blogging. So we have index, we have slash blog, which goes to a list of blog entries, slash blog slash a number which will go to the blog entry with that ID, slash post, which is where you will post a new entry, and slash API slash, and here you have a type that will be defined the same way, and that will be if you want to have API endpoints to retrieve as JSON the list of blog entries or something like that. And here you define the actual website itself, so this is defining the full website as a value type sitelet of endpoints, and so this will this will automatically be able to match these URLs, convert them into the corresponding value, and then here you use pattern matching, and then you return the content that you want for that particular endpoint. And so all these function calls are going to be called into the mixed server client tier that we're talking about. So here is the server part of this mixed tier, where you just create a page. So again, this is all written in F#, and here you see client side. Yeah, so this is HTML in the embedded DSL that we have to generate pages. You can also have HTML templates where you just fill in the holes with F# code like this. And here we fill in the hole with client side, and this calls to a function that is actually compiled to JavaScript and will run on the client side. So if we look at the definition of it, so this will be potentially even in the same file as the previous function, or if the feature is big enough, it's just going to be in the same folder in two files or something like that. So this is the client side code, which generates the same language to express HTML stuff, except this time it's generated on the client side. So you can put some event handlers and things like that. And here what's interesting, so we have the JavaScript annotation, which says all of this is compiled to JavaScript. And here we have a little module with a function that has an annotation that says RPC. So this is run on the server, but this is an AJAX endpoint that you can directly call from the client side. So here we have a function call to this, and when it's compiled, it actually compiles to serializing this to JSON, sending it, doing a request here. Here it's deserialized, we call this, we serialize the response, and we reply back here. And all of this, of course, is asynchronous with a very, very lightweight syntax to be able to do this asynchronous request and wait for the response, and then here continue doing whatever you need to do. So this way you can write your application all in one language, and you can structure it really the way you want. So now I'm going to be talking more specifically about UI.Next. So UI.Next is a library that focuses on the dynamic view and the dynamic behavior part of the stack. So it's going to be everything that all the code that you're going to see from now on is all going to be compiled to JavaScript and run dynamically on the page. So UI UI.Next is a reactive UI library which represents the potential, the possible interaction and the data that goes among them as an abstract data flow graph. It's strongly inspired by functional reactive programming and by concurrent ML in many aspects of the implementation. So the way it works overall is that the flow of data is represented as a directless acyclic graph where the input nodes are the user inputs, the data from the server, so every data that is input into the system. The internal nodes of the graph is the computed reactive values, so when you combine some values to compute something from it, this is going to be an internal node in our graph. And the output nodes, or in many cases the single output node, is going to be the DOM, with the visible effects are also going to be in this output node of the DOM. So how those nodes are represented in the type system? So there are two main types of nodes. So a var, which is for a variable, is represents the input nodes into the graph, and they are basically observable mutable cells. So they will behave the same way as a reference cell that you can set and get, but with the added capability that you can observe their changes. So the API is very simple. So you can create one with an initial value like this. So you create it with an initial value. You can get the current value of a given var, although that is rarely used directly, because that's basically to get the current value of an input node from outside the graph. But most of the time you're going to be observing via the views, which I'll be talking about later. You rarely directly get the value from the var. So you can set the value, so set the value of this with a new value, which will then be propagated through the graph. And you can set final. So this is a part which basically is going to optimize the part of the graph where you say, okay, this one has a final value that is not going to change. So we can freeze it and anything in the graph that depends on it and on nothing else, so that we don't need to listen to any other new changes. And finally, you can update it. So it's basically like a get followed by a set, but it's more guaranteed to be atomic. And there's a special kind of var which is called a model, which basically it's a special kind of var which represents a collection of data, for example, which is stored using some mutable type, but is observed as immutable data, so that you can optimize the way things are stored, but still observe it as pure data and benefit from functional style and propagated it through the graph with all these benefits. So one example that is implemented in the standard UI.Next library is a list model, which stores a collection of data as an array, which you can, so you can insert and remove elements and modify them, but you will view them as an immutable sequence that will just be considered a new sequence every time there's a change. And So how is this going to be viewed? That's with the view type. So the views are the internal nodes of the graph. They're the ones that react to changes from nodes higher in the graph, if we imagine it as going down. So one thing that is peculiar about views is that you cannot directly extract the value of a view. It can only be observed through the view graph, actually. And so that's one of the things that are present in UI.Next to solve some issues that are well known in functional reactive programming about basically if we allow doing all these things, which I will detail a bit later, and if we allow some things like viewing from outside and things like that, then you would have very terrible memory efficiency. You would be forced to store all the values as they have been computed, so that you can recompute the values from outside. So that's the limitation that there is. We can have all this functionality. So creating a constant view, so that's in the end going to be equivalent to creating a var and setting it to final. So yeah, that's useful in a lot of cases where you have a function that expects a view, but you want to put a constant in there, so you use a constant view. You get a view from a var, so there's a var that is the input node, and you just observe it. And so here, for example, if you have this var which we defined earlier, then you view from a var, you get a view which updates every time the var updates. Map is going to map a function on a given view. So here, if we have this view title that we defined just earlier, and we map this, then every time the title changes, then this will have the value of the uppercase version of it. A variant of it is map async. So here, the function that we map returns as an asynchronous value, so it doesn't necessarily return immediately. It can do an Ajax call or whatever else you might want to do that is asynchronous, and the resulting view will have the new value whenever it returns. And in particular, if there is a new update on the source view while the previous one is still being computed, then the previous computation is cancelled and discarded, and we start a new computation with the latest value, which can save some user's computation because we know that it's going to be discarded, so we can cancel that. So then we have some things like map 2, where we take two views, and this is where we start combining views, several views together, and we actually have a graph. So here we just take a function with two arguments, and we apply it to two views. So whenever one of these two views changes, our resulting view is gonna have a new value as well. So here, for example, we have a record with two fields, and we map to so from the view of the title and view of the content, the result will be updated every time. Now, if we want to have something that depends on 3, 4, 5, any number of views, we don't want to have a map 3, map 4, map n, so there's actually a way to write a map on any number of arguments, and that's using apply. So apply takes a view of a function, so that's applicative functors for those who do Haskell. And so this can be used if we define an operator like this that is equivalent to view apply. then here we have a view const, a function of three arguments that returns the combined value. And then if we apply it once to a view of string, then this returns a view of function of two arguments, which can we can then apply to another one, which returns a view of function of one argument, and then we apply it again, and we get our final view that has the type of this wrapper. So we can combine any number of nodes this way. So all of these so far are still composing a static graph. You can change the shape of the graph dynamically. It's always going to be the same graph. It's just the data that goes through it that changes. But in UI.Next, you can actually have operators that dynamically change the shape of the graph. So that's join and bind, which are so the monadic operators for those familiar with that. So join takes a view of view and returns a view, and bind is like map except the function returns a view, and so it's basically equivalent to a map followed by a join. So here, for example, we have a function here that, let's say, given a string, will return a view of a string list, which is all the related content that the search engine has found so far, and which will grow as the search engine keeps going, for example. And here we can if we have a view on a string, if we map it through this, so we get a view on this, which we then need to join, so that we can finally have a view on the string list, which we can then process whatever we want and display and everything. So yeah, so it calls the function, and then it updates whenever the return views update. So if those, yeah. Yeah, as the search engine keeps finding new responses, the result will get updated. So snapshot on that's the point of this is to be reactive to user events. So for example, let's say we have the page on which you post a blog entry. So we have the view that represents the entry that you're going to submit, which grabs it from several input boxes, for example. And we want to have a view that is that has the value of the blog entry when the user clicked submit, basically. We don't want to submit on every keystroke, obviously. What we want is to get the value to submit to be updated only when the user clicks submit. So snapshot on is going to be a view that is initialized with a certain value, and every time a view is updated, it gets its new value from this other one. So here, for example, we have the entry, which is the view of the current blog entry that is being typed. So we wrap it in some, which is on the option type, because we want the submitted entry at the beginning. We want it to be none because we're not submitting anything yet. And then when the user clicks submit, we want it to be some of the current value of the blog entry. So we initialize at none, and when OK is clicked. Which OK is a view here. When OK is clicked, then we get the value from entry. So and finally, here's the output node of the graph, which is so it's an imperative listener on a view, basically. And so what happens in UI.Next? Is that a view is only computed if it is connected to a sync. So if you have a if you have a view that is defined, like for example, if if you define a view like this, but then you don't have this view connected to a sync at the end, then none of this will ever be computed. You will never compute the entry and wrap it in a sum and etc. That will only happen once it goes into a sync. Now you rarely call directly sync itself, which listens to it imperatively, because calling it directly is dangerous, because it can cause the kinds of memory leaks that I was talking about earlier, where if you're not careful, for example, if you put a sync inside a join or a bind, then it's going to forever be listening to views that are not used anymore for the rest of the code. They're not displayed, they're not anything. They're just gonna keep updating and not do anything from them, because it's not useful anymore, because the bind has switched to another view since then. So calling a single sync is basically the way that we can ensure mostly that you're not going to run into these kinds of problems. And so, like I said, you rarely call it directly, because instead of calling directly, you're going to be using the reactive DOM, which will be calling it intelligently and setting the DOM inside the function calls. So the Reactive DOM API is based around a type called doc, which represents 0, var, 1, or n DOM elements. So it's a monoid, which means basically you can create an empty doc, and you have a function that can append two docs together and get a new doc. And here it's just to concatenate any number of docs. So to construct DOM nodes, so you can construct simple DOM nodes, so create an element with this tag name, these attributes, and these children, or create a text node with a given string. There are some helpers for all the standard DOM nodes that exist, so that you don't have to type dot dot element with a string every time. You can just say div and you have a div. The most interesting part, of course, is the dynamic constructors, which create docs that are going to evolve based on views, and therefore based on your data flow graph. So there's embed view, which takes a view of doc and returns a doc. So that's quite interesting. So basically, you have your data flow, and you have a view map or something that where the function returns the doc that you want to display, and then you pass the results to embed view, and that so at this point you have the doc itself, and you can put it inside your documents directly, and it's going to be updated based on the view from which it comes from, which itself comes from all the user inputs and all the things that you got the vars from. So you can the same way have a text view that will evolve based on the view of string. So here's an example. So we create a small document. So we have a variable that stores the title that the user is going to type. So we don't have the input yet, it's coming soon. And here we create a small document that is an H1 with the current value of the title as its contents. So this will change dynamically as the title changes. And here we just have a view on the title that creates an H1 with the title uppercased, and this H1 is passed to embed view, and therefore can be placed next to another H1 nicely. It will the same evolve based on the inputs. Now, here's where we are going to bind to the actual user inputs. So all of these functions here, they create so an input, a text area, a password input, a checkbox, etc., etc. They all take as argument not a view like the other one, of course, but a var, so that they can modify the inputs into the graph, and then as a going through the graph until they modify the actual view itself. So there's a couple that just take a callback, but that's also very easy to use with a var, because var.set of a variable of unit has the type unit to unit. You can just pass that to a function that expects a callback, and that will set your var correctly. So if we add some of that into our little example, so here we now have a label that contains an input that will affect the title, and so any time you type into this input, each ones below are going to be modified accordingly. So then attributes, so DOM attributes, they work the same way as DOM nodes. They're a monode, so you can create empty attributes and append attributes that will that you can then insert into, as attributes of a DOM element. So creating static attributes, so just create a simple XML attribute, a style or a class that you can add to your DOM element. Or of course, so here for example we have here the input has a class like this that is passed as argument. And of course we have dynamic attributes which themselves can depend on the view, so you can have elements that whose class is going to depend on some user inputs or things like that. So working the same way, so here for example we have the input has a dynamic class of error, which it only has it if the RV title is null or empty, and if it's not null or empty then it won't have this class. So this is a simple way to show data user input verification dynamically as it's being typed. And now this is all nice, but it's a bit potentially a bit tedious to type HTML like this if you have a big document that's a lot of HTML to type in F#, when we would like to write HTML in HTML as much as possible, especially when we have designers whose job is to write HTML in HTML. We don't want to make them learn this when they already know a language that can express a lot of the same things. So that's where we have the HTML type provider coming in. So type providers, who here knows what F# type providers are? So basically, F# type providers, what they do is that they generate types and code during compilation. So here, for example, what we're going to do is we're going to give it the name of an HTML file, and it will, during compilation from this HTML file, generate exactly the same code as I showed before and put that into the compiled code. And so for example, if we have this, so this is the exact equivalent of the previous snippet, but using the type provider. So here we have the HTML template with a few special attributes to represent where it's going to connect to the data view graph. And here we have the F# code. So this is, here's where we instantiate the type provider, giving the file name. And from here, it generates a type, so template.doc. So we can call this method with a number of named arguments that are taken from the HTML file itself. So there's the title argument, which is present here as a var. So data var basically means this is the var that is bound to this input. And title is also here. So this syntax means text node from a view basically. But since we have a view and a var from the same type, the type writer is intelligent enough to know that, well, this is the same var and here we're just viewing it. So you can pass one var here, it's gonna be edited here and displayed here. We have title error, which is here, so data atr is gonna add an attribute or a set of attributes from the argument title error. So here is our dynamic class. And finally, all caps title here is again a text node, which this time, since there is no var with the same name, it's going to have a type view of string, which we see here. And I think there's a missing dot view after the rv type, because this is a var. So we need to get a view from it. So we do dot view or pipe to view from var. So I don't know about you, but I think this is pretty readable code to express the HTML structure and how it's bound to the user inputs and outputs. I think this works pretty well. And we are going to see a bigger example of that. So we're going to have a little to-do list application. Classic demo of Reactive UI, if there is any of those. So here's a to-do list. So you can type here. So no, go to Meetup. So here we have just a little view just to see how it can update at the same time. And if we click add task, then it gets added here. And if we click at one of the items, it gets marked as done. I will say, okay, let's clear the completed tasks, and it removes them. So now let's go to the code for this to see how simple the code for this is. So here is the F-sharp code, the full F-sharp code for that to-do list. And here is the HTML. So let's zoom in a bit. So here we have, some bits of interest. So here we instantiate the templating type writer. Here we created, there's a type task that represents a single task, which is composed of a name and a var that says whether the task is done or not. And then we create a list model to store all these tasks. So here we initialize it with two tasks. And it, this is a function that extracts the unique key for the task. So that the list model can refer to them uniquely. So here we create a var that will represent the that will correspond to the input box in which you type your new task. And here we instantiate the template with a few named arguments that are taken from the file. So some bits of the template language I didn't mention yet. So here, for example, we have so here is the main template. So there's the table it's stored where everything is put in. And we can see, for example, here, here's data template. So what this creates is a sub-template, which corresponds, which is the template for a single line in the table. So here, so for example, if we look in the F# code, it is it's instantiated here. So in the list item, this is our template, our sub-template for the rows in the table. And so this is actually pretty nice, because this means that since having these templates and sub-templates means that this HTML file, as it stands, I can show it displayed in a browser without having the actual application running, like the JavaScript connected or anything, and it will look like my final application. I have all the markup is here, there's no like external things or whatever. The things are in place correctly. There's just going to be one single table room in the table. And here data hole is this means that inside the std we are going to insert a doc which is going to be the rows of the table. Okay, so here in this container is where we're going to put all the elements. So here on the list model view, we do doc convert is basically going to take this this view of a sequence and call this function on each element, and that which returns the doc, and then combine the docs together and return that resulting doc. So it's basically a helper for a map and an embed view with some optimizations based on the keys in the list. And so here is so that's basically it. We can also have some direct event handlers. So here, for example, I put a direct event handler on the click event on a row, so I can do this, and this will be the same as taking this little thing here. So if I look at the code, so the toggle down is the event handler for that, which will just update the test that done with not, which will toggle the boolean. And so I think that's about it. Some other functions, of course, that deal with this model, that remove the item remove all the items whose task done value is true. This is the event handler for clear all the completed tasks. So yeah, some functionality like that. And I think that's all there is about this. Alright, so
So thank you for following this presentation. So if you wanna learn more, here's our website. Here's where we are on Twitter, and we are very present in our chat on Twitter. So don't hesitate to come by and ask questions if you want. Thank you.
When you update the list of items, in a way, then you update the, if you change the items, then it's propagated to the view, which is itself a scene, I guess, which displays all the information. And then you update it. I don't know if you are familiar with React.js, the library, which does some magic for the user when he also generates some DOM. Then it compares with the real, with the virtual DOM, with the real DOM, and then removes and adds what's necessary. It works like this. Under the hood, or there is some.
So no, that it doesn't work like this here. So basically, so this example is a little bit simple. So yeah, if you just write it like this, then the whole table is going to re-render every time you you add an element. But if you just you just need to do this with the same key function as your list model, then it's going to use this key to know which elements are modified and which ones don't need to be touched, basically. So it's more explicit, but it means we don't need to have some algorithms that diff things, etc. It's based on what the user says, I know this will change and this will not, basically.
Then another question, if you have some application, like what is the usual size of the graph and how do you debug it? I mean, when something is not working, then how do you inspect it and how do you fix it, debug it? What is the usual flow you use for developing the real applications?
It can be a bit difficult to debug it indeed. We're going to put breakpoints into the callbacks of view maps and things like that. That's going to be these kinds of ways to debug it. So yeah, there are no specific facilities. We haven't had big problems debugging this so far.
WebShopper has source mapping. So
yeah, as well. Yes, that's actually very a good point. So you can debug, and see your F# code in the browser's debug window. So that's when the generative JavaScript mode is generally fairly readable, but it's still very helpful for the source mapping.
It's a separate project, the compiler of WebSharp. It's part of the WebSharper?
It's part of WebSharper, yes.
It's also developed by you and...
Yeah.
Yeah, so this UI.Next is an extension or another library that is basically built on top of WebSharper. There's about 55 other extensions and libraries in the ecosystem.
Most of them are going, libraries to bind to some existing
JavaScript libraries. Bindings to JavaScript libraries, but there are abstractions like this one. So this is an abstraction for Reactive UIs. We have a couple other UI-related extensions or libraries like formats. If you guys, maybe that's a good paper to read, because that's also a theoretical functional programming abstraction. And then we have piglets and a couple of things, sidelets. So the ecosystem is also quite rich in terms of abstractions.
I have a question. What about combining other JavaScript frameworks or languages?
Yes.
Using it within your environment.
Yeah, so basically there we have an so we have an EDSL little language inside F-sharp to define the typed interface mm-hmm. to a given JavaScript library, and that will generate the F-sharp code that is able to directly call into it via natively, so that you could just use this F-sharp code and this works nicely. We also have a TypeScript type provider, which is currently in our premium offering. So basically, based on TypeScript definitions, it will automatically, no, it's not actually a type provider, it's actually a code plain code generation, I mean, binary generation, mm-hmm. which yeah will create the F-sharp code corresponding to a given TypeScript interface, and then you can go into the corresponding JavaScript directory.
Okay, but if I really need hardcore JavaScript, really deep into JavaScript.
I mean, you can put inline JavaScript code very easily as well. So let's say you want to have a function. So let's say you want to have a function. My function.
Mm-hmm.
So here you specify the. You say, oh, this.
How on your laptop?
So, for example, if this is a function that's an int mm-hmm. and returns, and you're going to say something like this. This just means this is not going to be able to run on the server side, so you have to call it from the client side. And here you put an annotation, you say, inline, and here JavaScript code like this.
Mm-hmm. It can have dollar sign x.
Yeah. Here, if you put dollar x, then that will reference this argument.
And it's not treated as a whole, but the JavaScript test expression is parsed actually and checked.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you can't make syntax.
Syntax check, I mean.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, it checks the placeholders and the types and everything. So. And this is why you normally want to actually type the inline. So the inline is of course JavaScript, but the function that it belongs to, of course, is a typed F-sharp function,
mm-hmm.
which has typed arguments and typed output. And you can't go wrong. So basically, if you type those correctly, then in the consuming code, you will always be right. You get red squigglies if you happen to have.
Okay.
You know, you need a string, but the function returns an int.
Mm-hmm.
Even if it's an inline function, it will still do the type checking for you. So it's going to
nice.
Be
That's
helped
nice.
By the F-sharp type system.
Mm-hmm.
So we lifted JavaScript into F-sharp and now we have more types in.
So what's the biggest advantage of the framework like compared to your competition? Like apart from
big
hits in F-sharp.
Yeah, so I mean, yeah, so the big advantages is typed client-side code, which reduces a lot mm-hmm. of mistakes and helps a lot when doing some refactoring. We've done some big scale refactoring. I couldn't even imagine doing in a dynamic language because you would always be searching so for where else did I use this that I need to change, etc.
And also type client server communication.
Yeah.
So you have your refactoring on the full stack.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, you can refactor your client and your server all at the same time, and they will be checked all together. So that's really, really helpful.
And oh, sorry.
What is the largest size of the website, web application that you know running using your library?
How big?
Measured in any kind of measures, I mean pages, whatever.
yeah, that would probably be CloudSharper, I guess.
The largest application?
Yeah, the largest WebSharper application. If,
or probably
if,
Fish.
Yeah, if we count only that, yeah, probably Fish, which is... so yeah, it's a website with... so it does blogging, Q&A, events, listing, job listing, a whole bunch of things like that. Mm-hmm. And yeah, has a JSON API, has all these things like that. And I don't remember how, like in terms of lines of code, I don't remember.
50,000.
Yeah, something like 50, 60, 70,000, something like that. So yeah, that's pretty terse considering the size of the application.
And by the way, so this is 50, 60, 70,000 lines that we're talking about. That's all F sharp. There's no JavaScript. Mm-hmm. We don't write JavaScript.
occasionally,
for templates and minor includes, but WebSharper also manages the dependencies. So if you have a page that uses different JavaScript libraries to make the content on the page, all those will be inferred and automatically embedded as resources into the page.
Yeah. So all you need to do is call the function and the script type will be added automatically in your page.
Yeah, so you will not have to manually like mess around with these manual includes and stuff. Makes it really nice. So you kind of can almost forget that you're writing client-side code because you don't have all these annoyances that you otherwise would have as a client-side developer.
Do you have an example of a really complicated project? Like not this 101, but...
Well,
like one file only?
For UI Next, you mean?
Yeah, yeah, just...
Or for WebSharper or anything?
WebSharper, yeah, yeah, WebSharper.
Well, so there are almost 100 examples on the website.
On the webpage,
yeah. So yeah, for some
we have sizes of examples, like for different JavaScript libraries, like D3, or, mm-hmm. I don't know, Babylon.js, or like there are several, like almost about 10 libraries for which we not only have one sample, but we have a host of samples. And those are actually linked from the examples page on the WebSharper site. And I guess we could show maybe one of these sites if you want to look. Like find maybe the D3 one. The point of these examples is not to be complicated. The point is to show that you can do a lot with utilizing code. So go to the example page. And I mean there is a whole snooker game. I don't know if Loïc's machine is good enough to run it. Do you have like a WebGL and stuff?
Yeah, I'm not sure it's gonna run well. I can always try it. I'm not promising anything.
So this is a standard example, so it has inline comments and stuff, so you can read through, you can read the whole page, you can read the full source code and everything.
It works pretty well actually.
Okay, well, we'll do something. hit the boss.
Okay, not that well.
A little bit more speed maybe.
It's pretty slow, but yeah.
So this is a snooker game that I think Google developed in JavaScript originally.
Yeah.
And then we took the library that they used, it was called O3D, which is basically like a 2D, 3D engine. I don't think it has a physics engine in it, does it?
No, I think the physics are implemented by hand in this example. So we translated it from the original JavaScript source from Google, and the resulting F-sharp was significantly shorter actually.
Yeah. So this is like 1200 lines, this whole game. Including the shaders and stuff. Which is an inline shader language. Mm-hmm. The rest is F-sharp. But the whole full source code is on the website.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That page that we came from. But show the so these are individual examples. We have a couple dozen of these examples on the home page. Or this page that we came from. Yeah, but so go down. Yeah, so go down to the bottom. So these are the examples that we're talking about. And and for some of the extensions, you know, like SentiTouch or Bing Maps or Candle UI, those are actually larger libraries. And then we have smaller nice demos that highlight the main features of those libraries. But if you go up now, and so these are community people, so some people built and then they share the source code. So you can see those applications, some of them are quite large, will keep going up. And so these are the example sites. I'm not sure if you have actually the D3, so just pick one of these and click on them, like the WebRTC maybe, whatever, Babylon is fine. And this takes you to a subsite that has n number of examples. In this case, there are three examples.
So you are in the D3?
Yeah, and do the D3 and don't put the dot samples at the end, because we haven't migrated that, so you can wipe it. So then goes to maybe the world tour. I like that because it's such a short demo. It just goes through all the countries in alphabetical order and then sort of rotates the planet into that position. And this is like operating from a CSV file, pulls up all the data, and it uses D3 to actually draw, you know, this convex thing. And the whole thing, I think, is like 50 lines or 60 lines of code.
D3 is a very functional style. Library in JavaScript, so lots of callbacks and mapping because of the active use. So, and typing can really help.
So, if you go to the source, this is the source of that demo. So, a lot of it is basically filling the style and you know, things like that and feeding in the data files. But otherwise, the main functionality is fairly small, just basically like giving all the data to D3. Work with it. So there are very interesting and very powerful things you can do with D3, and with the binding that we have, it's basically a one-to-one binding, so you can almost write exactly the same in F# that you would write in JavaScript. So people who are used to writing these in JavaScript are going to find no problem writing all that code in F#, but with the F# one, they are actually going to get the type checking and the whole type system help. And it will significantly speed up their development if they continue in F#. And the code that we output is going to be almost the same as you would write by hand in JavaScript, because all of this is inline. And like Andras was saying, D3 is actually has a nice functional API, so you can program nicely and, you know, work with large data sets, do filtering and stuff like that. So it's quite nice. Many other libraries, JavaScript libraries, are not so nice, they're not so functional. So what we end up doing often is, once we develop the one-to-one binding, we actually build a conceptual, more functional API on the top. This is what we're doing with charting, for example. So we have a functional charting API coming up as an extension. You can plug in any kind of rendering charting library underneath, like Google Visualization or ChartFS or anything else, but the API, functionality that you write, let's say you have some data source, you get the data out of it, you pipe it into a line chart, that's like one line or two lines of code, but underneath you can say, I want this to be rendered using chart.js or Google Visualization, and then this layer will take care of all the details of how to do that. So you will remain extremely productive as a developer, because all you have to worry about is how to functionally and almost declaratively say what you want. And from there, the framework and the extension will take care of the rest.
And it's actually this same or almost the same API as a standard F# charting library for the desktop.
Yes.
You can take your code that was written for the desktop, just put the JavaScript annotation on it and reference WebSharper charting instead of F# charting, and just run that, and you have it on your client side.
Yep. I mean, we haven't really shown CloudSharper here, because it's heading to UI Next and Reactive programming. But basically, CloudSharper is an environment similar to, for example, Visual Studio Online. So you do all your online development thing. But the nice thing, the nice differentiator for CloudSharper is that you have this capability to do interactive online web programming. So you get an FSI window in your browser, and you can type things, and of course, just like in FSI, so FSI is F# interactive, so you say 1 + 1, it says 2, okay, let's define a function that does this, and then you use it, and it's basically a top loop, but we integrated WebSharper inside that FSI, so So you can say things that actually result as a web content. So you can say, give me a button that if I click, it will say hello. And then you get that button in the F-sharp interactive window. And you click on it and it says hello. And then so basically, very soon you will be able to develop web applications incrementally and also iteratively and interactively.
You can already do
it nice.
Create a function which will be bound to the FSI session on the server, which is your local backend or cloud backend, and create a translated block later that calls it, that an RPC function.
Yeah,
so you can add the RPC functions interactively and just create use that uses them.
So in other words,
it shows up in an iframe and
the interactive part is not just for the client, but you can simulate a whole server side in interactive as well. And then the two sides can play with each other and inside the same little window. I mean, a typical example would be to define like a small function that does like real-time data feed, you know, getting from, I don't know, some public data source, and then building a UI on the top of it, which actually consoles this service running in the interactive window to actually do a plot, like a real-time plot, a chart, a line chart of some sort. So when you execute that, you will get a chart inside your interactive which actually updates live. So it's tremendously powerful, and there's all kinds of applications. So originally when we envisioned Cloud Charcoal, we didn't really want it for, you know, online development. You know, just basically developing code. We actually envisioned all these uses, like there would be people or companies that are doing, I don't know, day trading or financial analytics or whatever. They can do all that analytics, but write it in F-sharp on the fly and get their data immediately fed into this application that they are developing and do all that work and getting the answer and visualizing the answer right in an online environment without any kind of delay. And that's still the plan.
Two more questions. How many people developed WebSharper? It's your company?
Yeah, so in WebSharper, I mean, we have been working on WebSharper for probably 5-6 years or so.
Yeah.
And like every summer we have a couple interns coming, and we have always between like 6 to 10 people at the company. So over the years there have been quite a number of people working on it. Right now I can say we have, what, 5-6 people working on WebShopper full-time almost.
Yeah. And plus there are some contributors from the community as well.
Yeah, but ever since we open sourced it, that was several years ago, and then we had a dual license model where we basically had everything open, but you couldn't use it unless, so for closed source applications you had to pay a fee. And then we said, well, that's not very nice. So we gave up and then just put everything on Apache, and then people started contributing. And now we have a very lively community of people that actually care about different things. One thing we didn't show, which actually I think we should, is this WebShopper Warp, which is this layer. Just show my blog entry, that's the easiest. It's basically a very small library built on the top of WebShopper. It's about 200 lines of code, or 250 maybe. And it makes it really easy to get started with WebSharper. Mm-hmm. So like there is how you install it. You take any project, an F-sharp project, maybe like a console application. You say install package WebSharper.warp. This is a NuGet command. Or if you use packet, then it's those two lines. And once you have warp installed in your project, then those 6 lines, or actually 4 code lines, will give you a hello world application. So warp gives you a scriptable and interactive applications, either within your shell or, and actually these are also standalone. You don't need to host them in IIS. They self-host. So there's a little hello world, and then you can say, well, I don't want just hello world. I want to output HTML. Now it's an H1 tag. If you see the little difference there, now it's bigger. And then you say, well, I also want to say, you know, like, can I do 2-page applications? Sure. So now you have a root and then you have a / about. So these are 2 endpoints. And then you construct it as a cyclet and then you run it. So keep going. And then you have basically just this, but now there is a link to your application, to the other page in your application. But note how we created the link. We define a small shorthand operator, this right-hand arrow, which takes a label and an endpoint, and then creates an A tag with the right href. But the hrefs for the URLs for the different pages are computed from the endpoint's type. You don't have to manually say it's at whatever string. Basically, you cannot generate a URL that is incorrect using this. That's one of the advantages of WebShopper sitelets.
This is simple because if you have if you have an endpoint that has some arguments in the path and in the query and anything, then same thing. You just create a value of type endpoint and you say link and that will create the link for you and you can just put it in.
Yep. So if this wasn't enough, then we say okay, well now we can do single page applications, we can do multi page applications. What about applications where I also have a server and a client side? So here's a small snippet that has a client side as well. And it, what it does, it basically has an input box and a button, and if you click the button, it will send the text that you wrote into the input box to the server, and then it will output it back into the output, which is basically an H1 tag underneath. Or is this H4?
So this is not using UI.Next, by the way, this is using the the older HTML API, which is much more classical, so to speak. So yeah, you do actually directly bind the fans and set the text and things like that.
Yeah, and the critical thing to note is right on the top, it says server. So that's a function that is defined.
That's equivalent to the RPC that was before.
Yeah, and then the whole module underneath is client. And then the site is basically putting those two pages on a single page application. So warp.createSPA means create a single page application. And the and that single page should say hi to server, and then a div that wraps all this client-side functionality. And then if you scroll down, then you see this. So when you say hi, whatever you type, the server will then, in this case, reverse the text and put it back to you. So this application is 40 lines. And you can host this, as I said. So when you run this project, it will create a self-hosted executable.
Or project, or if you just put this in a script file and do FSI exactly.
Well, you can run this from Interactive, which makes it exceptionally nice to develop these applications. So this is what we call self-hosted or scripted applications. So Warp speeds that those kinds of application development significantly, and I think it really makes a difference. Ever since we announced this, we created a channel, and there are all kinds of people coming to the channel and asking questions, and it's just such a great thing to see all that interest. And the application that gets created, by the way, is an OBIN-based application. So we don't have our own web server. We had at some point, but we decided to scrap that project. So now we generate applications that can be hosted anywhere where you support OBIN. And there are several web containers that can run these applications, so we're not pinned. In this case, we generated an exe, but we could have generated a DLL that could be hosted basically in all of those containers on any kind of operating system that runs them. And of course, normal WebShopper sitelets are ASP.NET compatible, so you can always put them in IIS. So basically, you can put them in IIS and everywhere else on any operating system. So this code runs anywhere. And I think that was all for Warp. So we have some major plans for simplifying even more of how you can get started with more complicated applications, like RESTful applications, for example. So that's in the next iteration in a couple of weeks' time. We're going to be rolling out some major updates to how you define a REST service, for example. It will be like 10 lines to do REST applications.
And you touched support for IDE. You are a Emax user, as I saw. So, what is the support for other environments? Like how you develop? You have a REPL or with
so
worse
WebShop,
so yeah, for WebShop and for WebSharper, how do you interact with the running server, running application?
So
here where it goes, so for a sharp here, there is actually the code service running, which, for example, here this is red because there's a type error, which you can see here. So you do have the code service and the code completion that is there, and everything is cool. Yeah, the screen is a little big, but have the code completion here. And then running the server is, in general, I just have my shell next to it, and I do XSP in the folder, and it's serving. So that's test.
And then the same for VI, right?
I think VI has something
similar. Yeah, I haven't looked into it much because I don't use VI, but yeah, it's.
Yeah, and then people at Thomas and a couple of the people from the community, they developed plugins for Atom.
Yeah.
And then, of course, Visual Studio Code. And I think Sublime Text also has good F-sharp support.
Yeah.
So when I say good F-sharp support, I mean code completion, syntax highlighting, type errors as you type. So that's pretty high level, I think, in general for F-sharp.
Yeah, and there's stuff that is currently in Visual Studio and should be coming soon to other things like refactoring, renaming, project-wide, or things like that.
And it's for both F-sharp, which is compared to .NET and JavaScript.
That's for F-sharp in general, which is both, both users.
And by the way, so we mentioned CloudSharp, it basically supports all of these operations as well.
It uses this, so it's basically the community project of the code service which provide this interface that can be plugged into any editor.
So the one nice thing about CloudSharp, like I said, is this implicit integration with WebSharp. So you are in an online environment, but when you do like interactive sessions, you actually can generate output that is not just a number or a string or anything that can be printed in the traditional interactive window, but also web content, which makes it really very, very nice. So, but otherwise, if you have a WebSharp application, you pretty much can use all of these choices for your IDE and either start your applications manually or some like Visual Studio have full integration as a built-in web server. So does CloudSharper. We also have a built-in web server in CloudSharper. And you know the workflow to take code from like a slide like this into the IDE and running it and deploying it is like one click. We don't have good debugging in CloudSharper, but Visual Studio has good debugging. We have source maps, so you can very conveniently debug in the worst case in Visual Studio.
What we don't have now is the WebSharper related errors as you type, but
because it's a separate compilation stuff.
Possible.
Alright,
I think you're
off the
books
again.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.